Okay, they're coming in. Here's Tim. Hello, Dr. Upshaw. All you MDs and PhDs gonna give me a complex. I'm just glad y'all all belong to 50 Hoops. That's what we
want. Amen.
Okay, they're coming in. They're starting. Hello, Mrs. Patterson. Let's talk when the meeting's over, because I am so excited to hear. Now, Sheila and her husband, they also here in Dallas, and they are really working out of that OCBF comprehensive. They are in a mega church, Oak Cliff Bible Fellowship. How many? 10,000, 20,000 people?
11,000.
11,000 people.
And Pat's given us 4 events that we are working on. And we 4 months.
Yep.
But the Lord and is
Sheila
there.
Always is very good. She's over the prayer. Her and her husband are up 24/7 one day. Not 24/7, but 24, almost 24 hours a day. Doing prayer ministries. They are so busy. They're so busy. Just like all the rest of you guys.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Let me introduce and welcome Pastor Lester Singleton, who will give us some words of wisdom, some words of religion as we move forward with this meaningful dialogue. Pastor Lester Singleton, please.
All right, thank you. So let's bow our heads for a moment, if you will. Lord, once again, Lord, we want to thank you for allowing us to be in your presence. We thank you, Lord, for bringing us thus far on this day. And now, Lord, we ask that you would invoke us with your presence. We give you honor. We give you glory because you are so awesome. And we just want to say thank you for everything and all things. Thank you for blessing us this event, our families, 50 Hoops, and Lord, have your way in our event today. Bless the speaker, Lord, who you have impacted with some awesome knowledge and word that they will give us today, this evening. And we want to say thank you once again in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much. Let's proceed. I'm Dr. Thomas Britt. I think I was inaugurated as a quote-unquote legend last year at the bedside of Dr. Mason. And I'm the immediate past president of the American Association of Public Health Physicians, past chair of the Public Health Department at Chicago State University, and I'm the current president of the Health Policy Institute here in Chicago. Dr. Mason has traveled along all of these events and organizations that I've been involved in. He's also the past, let me get this right, Terry, you have a whole bunch of things that you've done. Dr. Mason is a urologist. He's retired as a urologist, but after his retirement, he worked with the city as director of the public health department of the city, public health department at Cook County. If I made a slight mistake, Terry, correct it, and go ahead and let's get started. Dr. Mason?
Yes, sir. Well, thank you, Dr. Britt. I was muted a minute ago. I just make sure I'm still not muted. Am I okay?
Yeah, I can hear you just fine.
Okay. Well, thank you for that kind introduction. Dr. Britt and I have been traveling this road back since about 1974. And we've done a lot of things together. And my work in urology for over 26 years, dealing with men with all of the issues that men come down with regard to prostate cancer, erectile dysfunction, and those two to name just the main two, but also understanding and trying to make sure that we put in a opportunity for us to teach about nutrition. Because I would say that, and the data supports that probably just not less than 80% of the foods, that 80% of the diseases that we have, we call them things like coronary artery disease, and we call them things like cancer, and we call them other kinds of things, but these are really all food-related illnesses. And the data bears that out. We did, just parenthetically, we did a study, a small study at our church that we would love to be able to do a much larger one at Trinity United Church of Christ, where we actually took people and asked them for the month of Lent. We measured all their blood chemistries and what have you before, when they were eating whatever they wanted to eat. And then we gave them the food that we wanted them to eat, which was all plant-based, for 40 days. And inflammation is one of the key factors in the progression, promotion and progression of cancers and cardiovascular disease. And in the time that we were in Lent, those markers went down by 40% in just a matter of a few weeks. So if we were to think about what we could do if we ate this way all the time, and Pastor, I mean, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe in the first book of the Bible, God gave us instructions on what we're supposed to eat. And because we're not eating that, we're sick. And he said, I give you every seed-bearing plant, and they should be yours for food. Now, people, I'm not trying to preach nothing or anything like that, other than that the truth and the power is in plant-based eating. There's no question. It's not a diet. It's not anything like that. It's just a way to eat. And I bear witness to a loss of probably over 40 pounds just by doing that and doing a little walking. So I'm grateful to be on this panel. I've had the opportunity to work with folks like Billy Davis and his wife, Marilyn McCoo, because we wanted to do a thing called Not By Myself, because Black men didn't have anybody to go and talk to about this. So we also started a support group at the hospital to support them and to make sure that there were places that other men who were going through what they were going through, so they didn't feel alone. And that was why we called the movie, it was called Not By Myself. And I believe you can probably still watch it out on YouTube. But I want to thank Marilyn and Billy, because it's important to have the wife involved or the partner involved, because prostate cancer, particularly surgery, because of the attendant complications that you can not necessarily have to have, but certainly erectile dysfunction being among those, we need to make certain that everyone is involved and informed as well as possible. So I will stop right there, Dr. Britt, unless there is questions.
Okay, do we have any questions from any of the people? I've admitted three or four people, maybe four or five people on the who's in the waiting room. Do we have any questions from the other legends, or we have any questions or comments from the people who just signed in? Okay, I'm waiting for a response from anyone. Unmute your device and let's have it, please. Okay, I see a hand up. Sheila Patterson, please.
Dr. Terry, that sounds wonderful, because one of the ministries I have is glorifying God with your body, coaching healthy behaviors. And as a two-time cancer survivor, now I have not become a vegan, but I eat a lot of vegetables, and that has really helped me. I'm trying to get my husband in here because he's a prostate cancer. He's on the phone talking to someone else. And so that is very important. Yes, every Thursday I lift up a prayer about eating healthy and exercising, because it is from the Lord. So, yes, I totally agree, and I wanted you to do something for us in the future.
Well, we raise this money, we'd like to do a bigger study and have something powered well enough to show without any doubt that this works. And it's nothing, the one point we want to make is there's absolutely nothing wrong with Black people. That we don't have these diseases because we're Black. We have these diseases because we have been eating the wrong things. And the foods that we have been eating, a lot of the processed foods and things of that nature, are the cause of why we are where we are. It is not because of our genetics. Our genetics are strong. We survived everything that they threw at us and we're still here. So it's not that. And this is not, I don't mean by going on a diet. I do not support people going on diets. A diet is a project with most people psychologically creating a beginning and an end. Now, I don't like that. You decide you're going to eat this way for life, and then you don't have to worry about it anymore. So, and I know that we got to understand that the medical profession doesn't make any money if we don't have people that are sick. So we, as you can tell, there's a lot of money spent in our system, not badly, because when we get sick and you need to have whatever it is you need, but you need to also realize that you have a responsibility. Just quickly, as we did when I was at county, when we learned through the American Institute of Cancer Research that a few slices of bacon every day could increase your colorectal cancer risk by about 18%. We stopped serving it. We stopped serving hot dogs, and it created an uproar. But we have to make some decisions, because when we're sick and we go up to the pastor and we want to have laid hands on, no. You need to lay your hands off of the stuff that made you sick and begin to lay your hands on the things that come from our creator that is specifically designed to keep us well. And do you know that we spend about $7 billion on medicine for constipation in America? Why do you think that's so?
Let me jump in real quick. And people like to hear organizations who've signed on with this. One of the biggest organizations in the world is WHO, the World Health Organization. They have said emphatically that the best vaccination against chronic diseases that occur chronically is good nutrition. And good nutrition is primarily, it's not exclusively, but primarily a plant-based diet. So that's really great news. And the data will show that that is in fact the case. I see you have your husband sitting beside you there, Ms. Patterson. I see him smiling. Maybe he has a comment or a question he'd like to raise. Sir, please go ahead.
I'm just enjoying the conversation. I agree wholeheartedly with the diet and nutrition as well. I'm not a plant-based totally person, but we do restrict our diet to just chicken and turkey, and primarily. We rarely eat red meat, but we do eat sometimes. But we eat two meals a day, and we do a smoothie with the first meal with turmeric and beet powder and ginger. So we're making vegetables, fruit and vegetables. We start our day with that. So we're only two meals a day. So, but we're not totally on the plant-based diet. But well, I just turned 80, so if something's gonna get me, it's got 20 more years to get me. I feel blessed, but you know, I've had my valleys. You know, I'm a prostate cancer survivor, mm-hmm. but my dad passed away from that. So I've been concentrating on doing the best I can, because I know I have that genetic propensity. So. But so far, it's been about, I guess, since 2011 or 12, you know, I'm still here. So God still got some things for me to do.
And we were at the party and they rocked. We danced the night away. It was so much fun. Everybody over 65, we partied, okay? And I'm 72, so, you know, we eat healthy so we can stay. I guess I look like I'm 72, but him 80.
I hate to jump in and say something.
I'm sorry. We're not supposed to take over this conversation.
No, you're doing just fine. But I think you guys lying a little bit. 80 and 72, that ain't we not buying that. No. I mean, when you say black don't crack, I mean you really say it, what I'm looking at. Good Lord. You got wrinkles.
Yeah, well.
And I know we're not supposed to take care over this, but my mother died of breast bone brain cancer. My father by prostate cancer. Her brothers had various forms of cancer. My father's brother. So every part on both sides of my family have had cancer. I've had ovarian and breast, but I am cancer-free survivor because I caught them both at stage one because of the things of eating healthy, exercising, praying to the Lord, and doing all processed foods out of the way now. I'm not a total vegetarian, but I eat a lot more vegetables than him because I've got to work harder. And I have my children prepared, both of them, to test for prostate, to test for breast cancer, because I want them to be at stage one or no stage. And so that's why that ministry at Oak Cliff Bible Fellowship, that's why I do that comprehensive cancer support group once a month, bringing people like you, Terry, and others, and the comprehensive caregivers support group once a month, every month, and every Thursday, do glorifying God with your body, coaching healthy behaviors for people to exercise. The coaching healthy behaviors, I have chefs coming in to tell them what they have to have and how important what things like ginger and turmeric and all those things do, so that you do not have to lay in the bed or go to heaven before it's your time by eating healthy and feeling better in your body.
So if I can brag, these are my cousins. That's right. Lee Patterson and my grandmother and his grandmother were sisters. Can't you see the resemblance?
Yeah, like old Black folks say, y'all show favor.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry, but you know, Terry, that is what I have been working on all these years, what you're saying, and it is so true, and it's helping so many people.
Dr. Britt mentioned briefly about the farm. We partnered with one of the churches in the city of Chicago, in Lansing, Illinois, and took over the farm operations there. And we grew over 24,000 pounds of food last year.
Wow.
We plan to do even more than that. We grew our own collard. We do four types of kale collard. We did turnips, mustard, spinach, squash, watermelons, everything. And we as a people need to control our own food supply.
Amen.
And food needs to prepare like our grandparents and great-grandparents did it locally, not getting stuff shipped in for hundreds or thousands of miles away, but we should have the food locally, and we should do it. We should be relying on anybody to do it. Our great-grandparents did it. We fed ourselves. And we ate fresh things all the time. So that's what we're trying to do. And we're grateful for the work that we've been able to get done out at Vernon Park. This year, we're looking at even much more. We actually use bees, our own bees, to fertilize. And then we have the honey afterwards, as well as the beeswax. So there's a lot of things that we could do. And we should begin to think collectively on how we can leverage the resources, probably sitting in your churches and in your men's and women's groups, to make this happen.
So years ago, we did try to do a community garden at Oak Cliff Bible Fellowship. And for a year, ended up with Lee and I doing it until we just said, okay, we've got all these members, but they wanted us to do it. They didn't have time to be there in the evenings or the afternoons or the summers. So we had to give it up, but prayerfully, maybe one day in the future, we can restart it again. So yes.
Ours is a community-sponsored agriculture program. So people have to buy the shares. So yes. You buy a full share, and that full share entitles you to about, 24, 25 pounds of food, not including the weight of a watermelon or a cabbage. And you pay that up front. And you get food every week,
every other week,
just until Thanksgiving.
Investment makes it important, Terry. It is. That investment makes it personal. You're right.
We've hired people from the community. We've hired returning citizens, and we have some volunteers from high school and some volunteers from colleges who come out and till the soil and help harvest the produce. The produce is actually, we distribute it between the months of July through probably right before Thanksgiving. And then, we have to prepare the soil for the next season. So that's what we've done over the past. Well, actually, as Dr. Mason said, we took over the management of the farm this past season. We've worked with the farm the season before that, and we decided that we could do a little better job managing the farm last season and this season. So, you know, if food is the rate limiting step for good health, if food is the principal determinant for good health, you should control the food. And if you're not involved with farming, you're not really controlling the food. Someone else is controlling the food. And so we decided we were going to go all in and control the food from the farm to the table. Don't get no better than that. The truth be told is some of the food that we sell, they come out and if we have a commercial client, they come out and pick it up on Saturday morning. And by 2 or 3 o'clock, they're feeding it to their customers. I don't think you get better than that. There's no fresh.
No. Dr. Brown is in. Hi, Darce. Are you in?
Yes. Hello. How are you?
Yeah. Yes. This is Dr. Mason and Dr. Britt. Start talking about prostate cancer and it just a natural evolution into diet. And did you have some comments on that, Dr. Brown?
No, it's always wonderful that when we talk about preventing diseases is that many times there is a component of lifestyle. If we're looking at prevention, we have to, again, look at our diet and exercise. And so that's what I've been hearing, and that is wonderful. And some things we have to do in moderation, but it's left up to us to realize that we have to protect this vessel, this precious body that we are in, because it will wear out. It will get diseases, but again, if we practice prevention, we're likely to have greater longevity. So this conversation has just been very wonderful in hearing the things that we're saying. So thank you.
Let me jump in a little bit. So I did a little research on this myself recently, just to polish up on my current knowledge base. There are some types of food that should be avoided, prostate cancer, perhaps avoided for any kind of cancer, really any kind of disease. And some of the things that you should not do, you should not char those of us who still eat meats, you want to avoid charring your meat. When you char your meat, you develop something called heterocyclic amines. Heterocyclic amine is a carcinogen. So you don't want to char your meat. You want to decrease the amount of saturated fats you have that you get from butter and fatty meats and sweets. Those of us who still going to go out somewhere, I don't want to call no names, and have yourself a steak, you want to eat steak sparingly. You want to decrease the amount of red meat. You want to decrease the amount of dairy. What are some of the do's? You want to eat plenty of tomatoes. You want to eat your greens. Those of us who eat meat, you might want to increase the amount of fish that you eat. Fish like salmon, trout, and sardines, they're very good in omega fatty acids. You want to increase the amount of vitamin D. Vitamin D is more than just a vitamin, it's a hormone, and vitamin D is anti-inflammatory. Those of us who eat meat, we might want to increase the amount of Mediterranean diets we have. They are high in fruits, high in vegetables, high in healthy fats, and high in grains. So those are some of the do's and don'ts you want to get yourself involved with if you want to decrease the amount of prostate cancer, indeed other cancers as well.
Did anyone else have any questions for Dr. Britt or Dr. Mason? We were going to wrap this up in about 5 minutes, and we still got some gifts to wear. Teresa, you have been here. God bless you. Yolanda, you've been here. Beverly, you've been here. The future Dr. Timothy Upshaw, how you doing, sir? It's good to see you here as well.
Yeah, thank you.
Did Yolanda, Beverly, Dr. Upshaw, did you guys have any questions?
No questions. I really enjoyed just sitting here listening to everyone.
Yeah, it is. Robin, did you have a poll you want to run while Spider's giving out the gifts?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Great. Yeah, you know, I've just lost my connection. I'm on the phone and I don't see the polls on the phone. So
I hit the wrong thing. Can you hear me? Okay, I see the field research here. Let me launch this here, see if that works. Okay, there's a poll called Field Research there. Just take about 30 seconds. It doesn't take that long. You got yes and no. If you could get fill that one in. And then once we've gotten those answered, we have a evaluation. And this is a good test. We weren't able to run this yesterday. Are you getting this, Dr. Mason? Doctor, we want everybody in here to get these polls.
Yes.
Yes, I see.
Okay, yeah. Everybody here, there's about a dozen people in here. So everybody answer the polls if you can, and we'll have something for this. Now, while you're doing this poll, Ed is going to call out one of the names for the edible arrangements. And this is the dessert for tonight. You see, I'm eating a plant-based dinner, an apple, okay? That's my dinner tonight. So I feel good that I wasn't eating a ham sandwich. Okay. So you guys.
For the edible arrangement, we're going to select Teresa Powell.
All right. Teresa, did you get that?
I need you to send me your email, your address, name, phone number to PSOC. PEASOC at yahoo.com.
Okay, thank you.
We also have a silver anniversary t-shirt. It's not out as yet, but I need to pick someone for that as our winner. And that's going to be none other than Beverly Tucker. Beverly, I need your information, name, address, email. Send that to PEASOC at yahoo.com.
Okay, we can end this poll here. We've got about another minute. I'm going to close this up. Everybody's done with that. Let's see if we get another one, just a real quick one here. Let's see. Who were the other polls, Robin? Okay.
Pat, while you're doing that, Robin Kelly asked a question. Her husband asked a question. What causes prostate cancer? Terry, you want to take a crack at that if we got time?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. A particular thing that we know that causes, one particular thing that causes prostate cancer. We do know there's some things that will, you know, prostate cancer is just some of the cells begin to grow abnormally. And Dean Ornish has shown some great work that he's done showing that when you put a group of men in a program where they ate basically plant-based diets and they had yoga and they had other kinds of meditation and that sort of thing, comparing those to the ones that didn't, and the ones that did do that did much better. In fact, the kill rate of the prostate cancer cells in the group that did that was nearly 80% versus the kill rate in the ones that didn't was much, 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 much less. Secondly, I think someone else raised a question about milk. Cow's milk is something that is the absolute perfect food for baby cows. It has not been or ever been intended to be consumed by humans. It contains a thing called insulin growth factor 1. Insulin growth factor is the thing that helps to make the cells grow quickly because this 65-pound calf has to become a 400-pound cow. So those cells, the muscle cells and skin cells, need to grow very quickly. I'm sorry, not skin, but muscles and their other tissues. But we don't need to drink that. Every mammal, for the most part, makes milk for its young. And when a young baby, a human, is weaned from its mother's breast, it no longer needs milk anymore. And so that milk is also, with the insulin growth factor 1, has been implicated in not only growth of prostate cancer cells, but breast cancer cells and other cancer cells as well. So I that's real quick, but there's a lot more to that story, but I just wanted to get that part out.
Jason, I have a quick question for you. Would you say that heredity is the number one or two causes of prostate cancer? Is that a true statement?
I would not say that. And it's not, we pass down our habits from generation to generation. So there may not be a a familial, a gene or something like that, that predisposes you to prostate cancer. I'm not saying there isn't, but most of what we get is not coming down from necessarily genes as much as it comes down from the way we pass down our dietary habits and the things that we do and don't do. And so are there some, there's always a few people that may have a familial trait, but that's the minority of people, not the majority. It's like obesity and it's like heart disease. You know, we pick up these traits in our homes as we grow up, and a lot of them, and also the industry helps to foster this, because what they want to do, the fast food industries and what have you, they want to sell their products. And you can, and I mentioned earlier, obviously the stuff that they're helping us to eat more of than we need to is driving the other industry. I just mentioned that we're spending $7 billion on constipation. Constipation is a direct relationship to colon cancer as well as breast cancer in women. There's a great study that talked about this from a long time ago. And I'm sorry we don't have time to go through it right now, but I'd be happy to at some other time.
Do you have any web pages or links, Dr. Mason, that you could share with us in the chat? Or send
I am
to
no,
other-
not right now. I've just rebuilt the website, so we've got some things that'll be coming on the web page, which is just TerryMasonMD.org.
Okay, that sounds good. You can put that in the chat, and then we'll share that with our folks.
All right.
Yeah. Okay, Pastor Singleton, you want to take us out? This, I don't want to stop, but we promised 30 minutes, so this is really good.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay, Pat has asked you to take us out.
Okay, all right. Lord, once again, Lord, we just want to say thank you for just the impeccable knowledge that Dr. Britt, Dr. Mason, and even that Patterson gave us this evening. Lord, we pray that we would just take this awesome knowledge and just share it with our churches, our community, our families. And Lord, as we get ready to dismiss from this event, we pray that you will continually cover us with your grace and your mercy. And we thank you once again for the knowledge that we have received. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Guys,
congratulations, Dr. Britt. Congratulations on this this acknowledgement. And thank 50 Hoops for giving this acknowledgement to Dr. Britt, which is well deserved.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you.
You
are our legend, too. You know that. We've known you for over 20 years as well. Okay, guys, you have a blessed weekend, and just pray for all of us. God bless you.
Amen.
Oh,
I know I'm fabulous. I know I'm fabulous. I know.